My question is regarding something you commented a little while ago. Someone asked you regarding a Facebook post, what would be a better term than inerrant? And you mentioned amongst several that came up the word authoritative. Uh-huh. looking at historical, critical, biblical scholarship, whether mm-hmm. Old or New Testament, and the lack of consensus, even amongst the evangelicals, you mm-hmm. know, what the cultural background was in certain instances. I mean, do you go with John Sealhammer, who thinks, you know, the Genesis story is on the background of Egyptian mythology, or do you go with mm-hmm. John Walton, who thinks, no, it's an inauguration of a temple and God is getting ready to mm-hmm. enter, you know, the temple that's being built in 7 days. But, I mean, you go into the New Testament and you have a synoptic problem mm-hmm. of various, you know, authors, Matthew all the way through John, mm-hmm. who look at Jesus in a very different way. And let's say you come to a conclusion like Robert Gundry, who said, you know, we really need to understand that Matthew is more or less a midrash, mm-hmm. you know, that expands on Mark.
Sure, yeah.
And based on that understanding, he's basically posing the hypothesis that Peter in Matthew is portrayed as an apostate, mm-hmm. not like in the other Gospels, as someone who mm-hmm. got the second chance mm-hmm. or is actually going through a reconciled relationship with Jesus. Mm-hmm. So coming back to the question about authority, if there are contradicting theologies, mm-hmm. like, let's say Matthew is actually intending to contradict the other Gospels in the way they portray Peter. Which one is authoritative? Mm-hmm. And what is the message today for the church in regards to, let's say, apostasy? Right. I mean, this is now a really relevant question. What do you say to someone who's being challenged by ISIS, mm-hmm. renounce your faith or we're going to cut your head off? Mm-hmm. And they do renounce right. their faith.
Right.
You know, do we go with Matthew or, let's say, Robert Gundry's theory of what Matthew's
hopefully
trying
ISIS
to say?
Hopefully ISIS doesn't know that much about Robert Gundry.
Or do you
Gundry
go with
Matthew,
another evangelist that has
no,
a
I know what you're asking. I mean, it's a good question. It's a common question. I think what you're asking is, so how is the Bible then authoritative if it has contradictory information in it? See, I think even the word contradictory, I think, is already privileging a modern way of looking at information. Where this often goes is, well, God can't contradict himself, so I see these things happening in the Bible. They can't be, because God would never do this. In those days, it's all part of their tradition. It's all part of their stories, and they bring it together in one text. And maybe there the problem is what we've come to, the burden we've come to place on the Bible for giving us certain kinds of information that might not be there. I don't want to drive a wedge between the Bible and Jesus. I don't do that. But renouncing faith or not is not faith in the Bible. It's faith in Christ. Well, how do you know of Christ? Well, we know about Christ through Scripture. We also know through Christ through community. We know of Christ through our experience with community, right? It's not a matter of all the information lining up. I hope not. I really hope not, because it doesn't always line up. Luke Timothy Johnson is a New Testament scholar I like a lot. He's Roman Catholic, and he has this book, The Real Jesus, where he actually engages that question with the Jesus Seminar and all these kinds of things. And he says the real Jesus is the Jesus of all of the Gospels. Yeah, but how does that fit? I know that. I get it. The real Jesus is the Jesus of all of the Gospels. I think there's a lot of wisdom in that. But they don't quite line up. Yes, the real Jesus is the Jesus of all of the Gospels. It's not a matter of ferreting out what happened or didn't happen. Right? These are all, by God's design, the stories of Jesus we have in our Scripture. Right? And I think we need, at some point we need to say, okay, listen, we need to rest in that and think more about how to live this, right, than how all the things might or might not come together. People have been thinking about this for a very long time, folks. The earliest people in the church were thinking about how the Gospels don't line up. One guy, Tatian, tried to make them line up, and it was a disaster. Actually, it hung out for a couple hundred years with the Syrian church, but apart from that, people said, it's not working. There are four of them. They have to stay four. We have to respect them. Anybody else want to venture forth to this microphone? This is rather intimidating. Do you always do this here? Do you intimidate people in your church like this on a regular basis? Or they always come up. All right. So, okay, let's go there, and then we'll go there. Good, good. Oh, this is written down. This is go ahead. Okay.
You keep. Are we good?
Okay, wing it.
You spoke a lot about the authors of the texts, the world of the text. Why keep the language "word of God" when describing the Bible? Why not? What's so bad about a more minimalist, you know, bibliology, one that talks about the Bible as the word of the church, written to, you know, prayerfully, you know, left to us by our, you know, our church ancestors? But why bring God into it?
Well, see, I think that's a fair question. I don't see a dichotomy between those two things necessarily, right? I mean, you know, the Bible is, you know, in a very real sense, reflections of people on their own spiritual journeys with God writing reflections, for example. I think that's a perfectly valid way of thinking about the Bible. But I also think, see, when I say word of God, I don't mean, okay, now write this. No, comma. Okay, keep writing. I don't mean that. What I mean is, like, God is, by faith, somehow involved in that process, which I'm perfectly happy leaving open how that works, right? And for the church, it's always functioned in a way of parameters for our doctrine and how we think about the faith and life. That doesn't mean we stop thinking about things, but there's always been that sense in the church too of how the Bible functions, right? So, I mean, I'm all for keeping Word of God in there, but still, you know, I deal with this stuff. You know, that I'm a biblical scholar. I know people have differences of opinion in the Bible, and they write about God differently. And I see that's a lot of my book is about that. Actually, looking in the Old Testament at different times and places. People were reflecting about God differently, and we see that in the Bible. I just think God's a part of that. Yes.
I think it might be Phyllis Tickle who says that evangelicals tend to have a Bible pope, like we say our Bible's inspired and inerrant.
Yeah.
And so sometimes people say to me, well, that's interesting what you've said about the Bible, but the Bible says ... Mm-hmm. Is this... I would imagine people critique you the same way. Do you respond and say, well, it's just a matter of hermeneutics? Like, we just need to learn to interpret the different genres and...
Well, that's part of it. You know, that's part of it, because understanding, you know, ancient ways of talking, ancient ways of talking about God, ancient ways of talking about your own story, that is very important. See, it's, you know, hermeneutics is... some people call it the science of interpretation. It's not a science. It's about how you handle texts. And, you know, there is no straight, right? We're always interpreting the text. Even if, you know, it says right there, this was a 24-hour day in Genesis chapter 1. It's plain and simple. Well, that's a hermeneutic too, a literal one. That I think is the best way to read this text. We all do that, from the most conservative to the most non-conservative. We always have a hermeneutic. So I always want to talk about those texts and say, listen, you have a good point, but I don't quite look at it that way. Here's why I look at it differently. And, you know, can we talk about this instead of, you know, the Bible becoming more a weapon and sort of a slam dunk, you know, the Bible says this and you're wrong. It might be more complicated than that. One thing I talk about in the book a little bit, which another one of these sort of the growth moments for me is learning more about the history of Jewish interpretation of the Bible, which doesn't get quite as uptight as Christians tend to get about disagreements about how to handle texts. You have the Talmud, for example, which is an extended argument. Let's look at this issue. Rabbi so-and-so says this. Rabbi so-and-so says, that guy's crazy, it means this. The other rabbi says, no, it means this. The other one says, you're all wrong, it means this. Next verse. There's not the need. It's not always like that, but largely you don't need to resolve the issue, because I think this is, if I may, I think this is the genius. It's in engaging the text, even debating the text and debating each other, that's part of your spiritual community. I would love if Christians did a little bit more of that, saying, listen, we really disagree on this, but the gospel's not at stake every time we disagree about something. And that's a shame. I mean, it really, I hear that a lot. The gospel's at stake. Well, for you it is, because you have the system where it all has to hang together perfectly. But what if the Bible doesn't do that? What if that's not what it's for, right? I've heard that from Phyllis Tickle, but also, you know, Brian McLaren and others too. We have a paper pope. Brian McLaren says he uses the analogy of a constitution. Like, take me back to the days of kingship, you know, in England. But you know, when the good guys, us, well, not you, you're Canadians. What do you know about this? But when the Americans, God's chosen people, when we broke off from those nasty people back there in England, and we came here. We don't want no king. We're going to have a document. And Brian, I've never heard anyone say this before, but he sort of connects that mentality with our ecclesiology, where a book, the Bible, is like our constitution. And you debate it, and you argue it, and you fine-tune it, and you have your lawyers that go through it and say, this means that, that means that, in sort of a binding sort of way. I thought it was an interesting analogy to think of it that way, but... anyway. Yes?
What I was wondering is more, if you could talk more about your concern that you had when you were looking at Paul in that example of the rock traveling. What was the kind of the cultural maybe assumption or something on why it was such a concern that suddenly you realized Paul was taking creativity
because
there?
Because Paul wouldn't take the Old Testament out of context like that. You know what I mean? So... see, when you read text, you're supposed to read text a certain way. Respect what the author of that text is saying. Try to understand it in the author's historical moment as best as you can, and that's what it means, right? So that's the way you read texts. And I was taught that's how you read the Bible. And then I'm watching Paul not doing it. I'm watching Paul probably not even consciously thinking of Exodus or Numbers. He's probably just Jewish, right? And he's part of a Jewish way of thinking, right? I had this experience early, my first year at Harvard with, Harvard was fun for me. It really was. It was fun for me because I saw things that it's like, you know, I have an opportunity to take things more seriously than I have been taking them. One of my classmates was Israeli, right? We were talking at lunch one day, and I don't know how we got onto Genesis chapter 3, but I said, blah, 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 the fall. And he said, the what? In his little Israeli accent. The what? The fall. And he goes, what is that? Well, you know, Adam sinned, and as a result, death and sin enter the world, and now we're all born sinners. He goes, where'd you get that from? Where is it? And I said, well, you know, but when Satan is tempting the what? Satan's tempting Eve? He's looking at me incredulous. Have you ever read this? Now, the serpent was more crafty than any animal the Lord God had made. Whatever the serpent symbolized, you can't just say it's Satan. Now, what was happening there? I entered a conversation about the Bible with already a structure about how these things are to be understood. And here's the key point. I wasn't even aware of it. I like asking my students what the names of the wise men were, or the magi, right? Of course, they're not in the Bible, right? And one year, a student said to me, "This is classic." He said something like, "Oh, how did he put it?" He said in class, "We don't even know the names of the three wise men." Do you hear it? Three, right? Where's your Bible knowledge coming from? You know, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, or Charlie Brown, or... But the thing is that all of us, every person in this room, including myself, we have in our heads an interpreted Bible. We already have a way of understanding these things. We already come at it with a pre-understanding of how even some of these difficult things are supposed to work out. Until somebody comes along who doesn't share your assumptions, then all of a sudden, you've got to start thinking. And I just can't imagine God doing anything about that rather than just smiling. Right? He's not saying, you're going to fail your theology exam when you die. And that's going to be a horrible thing. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm into knowledge. I'm into theology. I'm into learning. I'm into understanding. And those things are not irrelevant, right? But we're only people, after all. I mean, what do we know? We're trying. And what if God's on our side? What if he likes you? What if he's your children and he likes when you figure things out or when you don't figure things out? What if he leaves you in those times and moments where nothing makes sense? That's a good idea, right? So I guess, in other words, let me put it this way. For me, this process has... And again, I don't mean to, this is not a dichotomy for me, but for me, this process has made me rely more on God than on my ability to understand how God works or understand the Bible. The Bible is a difficult book. That's why you have seminaries or Bible colleges or seminars. It's not an easy book to understand once you really dig into it and start reading it. I think. Or I'm out of a job if it's easy. Yeah.
In my fundamentalist upbringing, mm-hmm. the idea of getting creative with the text, it would just be a heretical idea. In right. fact, a couple of my family members think you're a heretic. I don't.
A couple of my family members do too, but that's all right.
Back to what you said about wishing you had a way to bring some of these things up growing up, and yeah. I guess it's something I'm struggling with my children, because yeah. my world's getting bigger as I'm asking these questions and getting really excited about the fact that that's okay, and yeah. Jesus gets bigger, not smaller, as I mm-hmm. do. But I'm wondering, how do we do that with children or mm-hmm. with people who are quite entrenched in fundamentalism, who are, because it is scary to deconstruct, and how do you broach this with people
yeah.
whose spiritual worlds they think anyway are going to fall apart, or with children who you're still trying to just...
Not screw up too badly.
Yeah, you want to give
know,
them
I
a...
Know.
you know, a foundation of confidence,
right,
you know, and I'm excited to be introducing my kids to these questions, but I'm always struggling with the balance of just how much to open the can of worms.
Well,
at this
that's because you're a good mom. That's why you're struggling with it. Those are two different questions, right? Because with adults, I don't bring it up. You know, I don't do that. If people aren't in a place where they're willing to have those kinds of conversations, they're not ready to have them, and they're not interested, and it's not my job to force them to be interested. It's hard if it's your family, and you want to connect with them, and you owe them a lot. You love your family, right? But there still may be a sense in which you might have to take the higher road of wisdom, of knowing when to speak and when not to speak, and how to speak and how not to speak about things, and love them anyway, right? And that's hard to do because they're so wrong, right? I'm thankful. I don't have that in my family. I don't have that issue. We have other issues, but we don't have that one. And that would be a difficult one for me. I know professors who are just at odds with their wives, and it's not like they're fighting or getting a divorce, but they don't have a connection that they can forge because their journeys are going in very different directions, and it wasn't planned. And it's a very hard thing to work through. With kids, there are things that I wish I had done a little bit differently with my kids, too, who are now 26, 24, and 21. And creating in the house a culture where the love and presence of God just is not questioned. It is God is the foundation, right? And a culture where asking questions, which all kids do, is revered. Because kids, I mean, who here has taught children Sunday school? I never have. I never will. I do not want to get near those kids because they ask the questions. Where'd Cain get his wife from? Like, what 8-year-old hasn't asked that question, right? No? And you start stammering, you know. And I remember, you know, when my son was 6, he's the 26-year-old, when he was 6 years old, when I was reading the garden story to him, right? And he, you know, I'm reading along, and he goes, like that. And I kept reading, and he goes, after like 3 or 4, I'm like, what? What, Eric? What? And he goes, Daddy, snakes can't talk. And my immediate reaction was, shh, he may hear you. Don't say that, right? But instead, you know, this is where trust, entrusting your children to God, I think, comes in. And I wish I had done a better job of not, well, here's how you solve this quickly. I don't think he was particularly bothered by it. I think he just wanted, Dad, snakes can't talk, so what's the story doing, right? It's more of an inquisitive kind of thing, and I think not to shut that down. Now, here's the problem, not to psychoanalyze you, but if you're from a fundamentalist upbringing, which I understand, that's a very risky thing to do with your children because you can't give those clear parameters about everything, that it all makes sense, right? And you're an adult on a journey, and I'm going to push it on my kids. Well, be a wise parent. If those questions come up, just flow with them. And if you can't answer them, they're going to go to sleep that night, and they're going to be fine. Right? I really do think that. And when they're 30, and they remember you praying for them and loving them no matter what, that's what they're going to remember, not, I got the right answer to that question. I really needed it when I was 7. You know, it doesn't work that way in my experience, you know. And I guess it's easy for me to say now, but I just relax. Be happy. You've got kids. You know, and maybe God's on your side too. And maybe it's not always going to be smooth or work out. Maybe there are going to be hard times. It's not going to be perfect. But maybe God's there anyway. I think he is. I hope so, or else we're all dead meat. Yeah. And I believe he is.